Here is the message we have heard from Christ, and now announced to you. God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. So if we say we have fellowship with God, but we continue living in darkness, we are liars and do not follow the truth. But if we live in the light, as God is in the light, we can share fellowship with each other. Then the blood of Jesus, God's Son, cleanses us from every sin. If we say we have no sin, we are fooling ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he will forgive our sins, because we can trust God to do what is right. He will cleanse us from all the wrongs we have done. If we say we have not sinned, we make God a liar, and we do not accept God's teaching. Today, this may be the closest you'll ever get me to actually preaching a hellfire and brimstone sermon. That's not really my personality to preach hellfire and brimstone by any stretch. But this is a little bit towards that end. So if you suddenly should be moved by the Spirit and you want to cry out, hallelujah, praise God, or preach it, brother, or any of those things, feel free. And after all, you might make me feel right at home in my old Baptist roots. Or if I should say, can I have an amen?
Amen.
Yes. Can I have an amen?
Amen.
Yes. That's very much, it's almost in the black church tradition. Sometimes if you've never been to a black Baptist church, it's an experience. It's also exercise. Today I'm going to be preaching, the sermon is basically fashioned or inspired by one of my own little sayings that I like to say. And that is, if when reading scripture, you never feel convicted, if you never see the hairy hand of God pointing a fat finger right back at you, well then you're not paying close enough attention. So many times when we're reading scripture, we should see that finger pointing at us. As a parent, God doesn't call out in scripture our first and middle name, as the root of the child, but often you'll see that fat finger pointing. The verse that I'm preaching over is actually the verses that were for the lectionary last week, and I was visiting with Norma about it last week. It was one of those things like, oh my, how do you preach over that in the church? We had talked about it in the Bible study on Sunday night. But this is one of those, I preached a sermon not too long ago about the difficult passages. And what I was getting at there is many times passages are difficult for us because of the way Jesus is behaving or talking, or the way God is behaving or instructing. And sometimes those things have to stop and go, wait a minute, Jesus, why are you calling this woman a dog? Was what that bit of the passage was. But this is for many of us, myself included, this is one of those difficult passages for another reason, and that it is a passage that convicts me. And there are others that this passage convicts. Now, I don't want anyone to, as I'm going through this sermon, feel that I'm judging or talking about any particular person's situation, okay? We'll get into that. But never judging. That's not my job. That's Jesus' job. This is in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10. Then Jesus left that place and went into the area of Judea and across the Jordan River. Again, crowds came to him, and he taught them as he usually did. Some Pharisees came to Jesus and tried to trick him. They asked him, is it right for a man to divorce his wife? Jesus answered, what did Moses command you to do? They said, Moses allowed a man to write out divorce papers and send her away. Jesus said, Moses wrote that command for you because you were stubborn.
But when God made the world, he made them male and female. So a man will leave his mother or his father and mother and be united with his wife, and the two will become one body. So there are not two, but one. God has joined the two together, so no one should separate them. Later in the house, his followers asked Jesus again about the question of divorce. He answered them, "Anyone who divorces his wife and marries another woman is guilty of adultery against her. And the woman who divorces her husband and marries another man is also guilty of adultery." This actually this dialogue is in all three of the Synoptic Gospels, with only very minor differences between them. In Matthew throws in there that Jesus provides an exception in that divorce is allowed if the woman is unfaithful, she's had an affair. But only in Matthew, these three passages are something that if you go to my blog back on May 22nd, 2014, right after my nephew got married, I blogged about this. I have pretty stringent feelings about marriage and divorce. And it's one of those places where I really say, I wish that wasn't in the scripture, because every time I read it, I cringe, because I've been divorced, and it was my fault. I filed for the divorce. It wasn't her fault at all. So I feel, when I read that, I always feel conviction. God's hairy hand pointing a finger at you. Remember that? You screwed up. Again, I'm not saying that there's never justifiable divorce. Many times there's physical, emotional abuse, things like that. There's lots of things that come into it. But it's pretty obvious when one is reading the scripture that Jesus is telling us that it's a sin. That's not something we want to do. The question of it is, why is it a sin, and what is the whole thing, the whole problem with it? And that boils down to, it is, first of all, marriage is a covenant. That's one of the big things that I stress with couples, and with the couple that's getting married in November. I'm really proud of them that they really have taken that to heart. But this is a covenant agreement, not only between them, but the third party is God. And in fact, they want to do a thing with Unity Sand, where they pour sand from each of them, and then they want me to pour a container of sand in, representing God in the marriage. And she came up with that, not me telling them they should do that. So I was very proud that they caught. Of course, how could you not catch it? I beat it in your head. If you don't catch it, you're slow. But at any rate, the problem with divorce is all sin. And it's the same with all sin. It's not just divorce. But divorce causes a break in that relationship with God and with each other. Of course it's with each other, but it's also a break. And this is what sin does. Sin comes in as a wedge, and it breaks. It's separating you for some whatever reason from God. And especially, it's easy to see it in this case. You're not supposed to do it, but yet it happens. And there's this rift, this brokenness. And of course, the whole world is broken. But this is a very obvious case of brokenness. And we talked the other day with the kids about, and I apologize because I screwed that little skit up the other day where I had Jeff and Lonnie come up here as John and Jesus. And I think that's my own skit that I wrote a couple years ago or came up with, and I screwed it up. Because really what it's supposed to be is Jeff was supposed to say, repent. And Lonnie was supposed to be representing Jesus. When John says, repent, Jesus is actually saying, come back to me. And it's supposed to be that Lonnie would say, John would say, repent, Jesus cries out, come back to me. Because that's what repent means. And the problem with all sin, divorce included, is it drives us away from God. And God is left there crying, come back to me, come back to me. And this is the reconciliation. The passages have become a little bit confusing with divorce, and one of the reasons why people used to say, oh, well, that doesn't apply in society anymore, because in Hebrew society in the first century, if you got divorced, the woman had no way to support herself except perhaps to go into prostitution. That would be the only means that she would have for support.
And you go, well, at first and for years, I was like, that makes sense. And I like that. I can go with that because it makes me feel comfortable. That's not the case anymore. She had a better job than I had. She made more money than I did. If I think it was all good, there's no problem there. The problem there is I'm rationalizing, I'm justifying, and I'm not paying attention to that finger continuing to point at me. And the thing is it's not about the woman being destitute and not having economic support. Because just right there at the end it says, if she remarries, the man she marries is guilty of adultery as well. Well, if it was about support from the woman, that guy should be heralded as a superhero, not convicted of a sin. Okay?
So, conviction. Turn to Galatians here. Of course, it's not only about divorce. In Galatians chapter 5, the wrong things the sinful self does are clear, being sexual unfaithful, not being pure, taking part in sexual sins, worshiping gods, doing witchcraft, hating. Anybody feel a finger point at you? Making trouble. Being jealous. Being angry. Being selfish. Making people angry with each other. Causing divisions among people. Feeling envy. Being drunk. Having wild and wasteful parties. And doing other things like these. I warn you now, as I warned you before, those who do these things will not inherit God's kingdom. There's a lot of fingers get pointed in that, right? Envy. Who has never felt envious of someone else? Who has not been guilty of being selfish at some point in life? Being jealous. There's no end to these fingers that are jabbing out and pointing at us here. And lest we want to go ahead and say, well, yes, but this sin is greater, this sin is bad. Being envious, that's not as bad as divorce. It's certainly not as bad as murder or something else. When we get into the book of James, we've got to remember that James tells us pretty emphatically that one sin is just as great as another. And if you commit one sin, you're just as though you were guilty of committing all sins. So there is no hierarchy of sin. So with the one caveat I would point out that continues to trouble me with the problem that you have with divorce is that you have broken a covenant with God. And that's extraordinarily serious business. This is not something one should ever do willy-nilly. But all of us, no matter who we are, what our station in life, what our background is, how faithful we profess to be, or how devoted to God we profess to be, all of us somewhere fall short of the glory of God. At some point, all of us feel that finger pointing back at us. We should when we're reading Scripture. Because I seriously mean that. If you never see that finger pointing right straight back at you, you are most certainly not paying attention when you're reading. Because it's going to be there. When we're seeing those fingers point back at us, and we're feeling this conviction, okay, God's judging us. The finger is pointing back at us, and we are pointing despair. I read those passages on divorce. It can weigh heavy on my heart. Those fingers are pointing back at me.